I'll never forget the very first words our kids uttered. There was buildup. There was anticipation. What are our kids going to say first? What will be their first word? And we had phones out ready to capture all of it. And we just wondered, is Addie going to say mommy or daddy first? Will Bauer use his first words to say Rocky Top, Tennessee? And so there is research, you should know, there's research all around this exact topic. What are kids' very first words? And there's a clear winner on what kids usually say for their very first word. And you ought to know, like, everything in our house is a competition. Everything, even our kids' first words. And so research study has shown by PhDs that typically the kids' very first word is dada. It is. We win. And no, everything's not a competition with you. That's okay. You're not as competitive like my wife is. And so, but what's more important in this research is that Stanford University found that the kids' first words, the very first words that kids use, are important indicators for the development of that child. Now, as we look at, and as we've been looking at now for a couple of weeks, the very first words of the New Testament, arguably many scholars would say that the book of James is representative of the very first words of the entire New Testament. These are words that are critical to the development of the local church, critical in these first few weeks of the life of a local church, the first few months, these first few years. And so James, as he's speaking these first words to the churches who are scattered, he begins by speaking that Jesus changes everything. Now, just to set the context, Jesus had lived and led an epic life. Jesus did things, accomplished things, taught things that were completely and entirely new. The way that Jesus lived and the way that Jesus led, the miracles that he performed, the things that he said, the way that he lived was entirely different. And we see the difference in these very first words of the New Testament. James, last week, as we kicked off this series, James starts with an introduction. And last week, we got through all of one verse. Now, this week, we'll hopefully make a little bit more progress than that. But what we see at the beginning is that Jesus changes everything. Jesus changed everything for James in this early church, but he also changes everything for us today. And that was news that people needed to hear. Because in that moment, in that season, in the context that James wrote, everything was incredibly difficult. Everything was surrounded with pain and trouble and problems, and they had pressures all around. And this early church needed the message that Jesus changes everything. This was a church, as we saw last week, that was scattered. They weren't in their homes. They had been run off from their communities. They were not meeting together because they were scattered. Does that sound at all familiar to us today? A little bit, maybe. And this was a church, though, that wasn't just experiencing life away from home. They weren't just dealing with the new realities of life away from their family, their friends, what they had grown accustomed to. No, this was a church who had many, many trials and tribulations. This was a church who was not only dealing with not being at home, but they were navigating trials that they had never experienced before. This was a church who had troubles that brought financial implications that nobody was prepared for. There were sociological effects and impacts, health impacts, people's jobs, all kinds of things. It's not just one thing that these followers of Jesus were walking through. It was the culmination and the compounding nature of many, many things. People in this day were disagreeing with one another. There was extreme polarization of opinions and politics. Sound familiar at all? No, nobody? There's people with strong opinions about what life and leadership in this world looked like. And on top of it all, James shows us that people's faith was getting tested. There was pressure on this early church, unlike any faith-based religion had experienced in human history. This was all happening all at once. There's a purging and a pressure, and James writes this message to a people under this great persecution, and maybe you can relate. James certainly could relate, because he'd experienced persecution when he decided to follow Jesus. James had experienced this pressure and this overwhelming amount of problems in his own life, let alone in his family, who his brother, Jesus, had gone through persecution and trials all throughout his ministry, even to the point where he was murdered by people even in his innocence. And so James knew some of these trials, but he also knew that the trials of life, the trials that we walk through, will probe whether we live by our faith or not. James knew, even in these difficulties, James was convinced that our response to these trials reveals our heart's condition. Let me say it another way. Crisis reveals our character. Sure, there are moments where crisis and chaos all around us start to kind of create and cultivate the soil within our own heart to shape who we are and who we become. But when crisis comes, our character is revealed. It doesn't create character within us, doesn't just create this character. It reveals what's already there. And we can't see the depth of our character until we see how we react under pressure. James knew this. He knew the reality of this, that we, our character is shown when crisis comes. Now, James, he feared in that moment the greatest danger for James was not the persecution that they were going through, but rather the character that was being developed. Now, typically when you're introducing yourself to someone, you take just a minute to kind of get to know them, take a minute to introduce yourself. Here's a little bit about me. But James didn't waste any time. He didn't mince any words. He didn't slow walk his way into the issues that this church was facing. No, James, on the other hand, spent one verse saying, "Hey, I'm James," and then dives right in James chapter 1, verse 2, to talk about the issues at hand. And the very prominence of this issue of the persecution and the trials that James is going to jump right into shows us that it's serious, that things are not great, that things are not easy, that things, even after following Jesus, putting your hope and finding your hope only in Jesus, didn't change some of the circumstances that they were in. And so James, as he writes, James chapter 1, verse 1, "James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes in the dispersion, greetings." Verse 2, "Count it all joy." James says, consider with me for a minute. Just think with me. Consider it all joy. Consider what joy? James, can't you see everything that's going on? Can't you see everything that's happening all around us? What are you talking about? Consider joy. Consider it joyful. Consider these moments to be happy. What does he say? Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. Wait. Hang on a minute, James. You're saying we can find joy even in the pressures and the problems of life? James, hang on a minute. You just said count it all joy when you face trials of many kinds. Thanks, that's all I've got. I'll be here all day. No, that, you can't just walk away after that, James. What are you talking about? What could you possibly mean? Can't you give us something practical, something helpful? Because, James, you know what we're walking through right now. How is that even possible? James says, count it all joy. James uses a term in the Greek here that's a term that refers to accounting. And what James is saying to us is when the balance sheet comes out, when the P&L sheets are published at the end of the month, when all of the things balance out, you can put in the win column, you can put in the profit column, not in the loss, you can put it in the for our good and joy column, you can put even suffering. You don't have to be an accountant or a business owner to understand, but especially if you are a business owner, you can see what point James is making in these very first words when he says, hey, listen up, everybody. Hey, hang on, hang with me for just a minute. I know it. I just ran through the introduction. I know I'm just diving into the deep end, but listen, when it all comes to the end, when it's all said and done, you get joy. You gain joy. You can put it in the win column even when life feels like a loss. So in those awful moments, James says, you can count it as joy. I mean, that's a pretty audacious claim. It's a pretty bold statement to make, especially with all of the persecution that these people were walking through. Now, in this instance, James isn't just talking about these. He's not talking about the moments and the seasons where we're going through pain because of our own knuckleheaded decision. James isn't just referring to those moments and seasons when the problems that we have in our life are caused by the direction that we've chosen to take in our life. No, he uses this word that we fall into trials of many kinds. Because if we're being honest, there's so many times where we are facing things that we have no control over. Whether that's a health diagnosis or a financial need or some kind of economic impact or different things that just fall into our life that happen in the circumstances of our life that are completely out of our control. And haven't we all faced something like this? Haven't we all faced trials and difficulties like this when something shows up and comes knocking on our door that we wanted nothing to do with and expected none of to show up in our own life? The political division and unrest, the stock markets, the rising prices, the rising costs, the inflation, the difficulties in the world that we've got no control over. And James says, in these times, in these seasons, in these trials, be joyful. Why? Because James's biggest concern, his greatest cause for concern, was not what was happening all around these followers. His greatest concern wasn't even external, it was internal. James feared much more of what was going on inside the followers of Jesus in this moment than what was happening all around them, persecuting them, bringing problems and trials and tribulations. James feared that his people, like other Jews in that day, he feared that many followers of Jesus, even today, would imagine that just simple belief and attendance in a church community of faith was enough to please God. James feared complacence more than he feared persecution. James feared that people would be strong in knowledge and weak in life. And so James lays this foundation that when trials come, when problems arise in your family, when issues come up at work, when trials and tribulations of many kinds show up, not if they show up, not, hey, it's possible that this may happen in your life. No, when trials come, when many things happen that you didn't know about, when everything starts to crumble and spiral out of control, when trials come, you can have joy. How in the world is that possible? James goes on. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, so that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. James knew that faith produces perseverance. And perseverance, when it develops, brings about maturity. And friends, can I tell you, you need maturity if you're going to make it in this world. I'm not just talking about physical maturity. I'm not just talking about you grow up, you mature. We all do. That happens naturally and normally. What James is referring to here is we need to be spiritually and emotionally mature. This steadfastness, this enduring faith, this faithful living brings about a maturity to act and live and lead and talk and respond like an adult when trials come. James is much more concerned about what God is doing in cultivating our character than he is about changing the external circumstances. And so he says in this moment that what God is doing in you is more important than what's happening around you. Because we as followers of Jesus respond not based on our situation, but based on our Savior. Now you may know someone who's, when trials come, you may know someone whose faith is just rock solid. You see the maturity in their own life when difficulty comes, when the diagnosis doesn't change, when life happens, when those hurts show up in our own life. You've seen it in those mature believers. They've just got that rock solid faith. They know who God's made them to be. They're confident in who God's created them to be. And so they live with that confidence even in chaos. We've seen that at times. And we wonder, where is that from? Where did that happen? How did they have that? Because looking at the circumstances of your own life, it may just look like problems. I remember a couple of months ago, I woke up with this just excruciating pain in my elbow. I don't know how it happened, and like that's how you know you're getting old. You have some sort of injury, and you're like, oh, where did that come from? I don't even know. Like I was sleeping one night, woke up the next morning, and I've got bursitis in my elbow. And I don't even know the full extent of what bursitis means, but I do know my kids weaponize it against me and think it's funny. And so I woke up with bursitis, and let me just tell you, this pain, this excruciating pain in my elbow impacted everything about life. It changed the way that I try to rest. It changed the way that I worked, how I drove. I felt this pain in everything. I'd sit down for a meal and my elbow would hurt. I'd stand up and walk around. I'd try to do different things that were part of normal life. And yet all the way through experiencing this excruciating pain, I remember thinking in that moment, like, gosh, I wish I could just get rid of this bursitis. Like, it's not going away, and it still hurts, and I just tap it on something. And gosh, wouldn't life be better if I didn't have this bursitis? Which is oftentimes what we say to ourselves when we're walking through that painful circumstance, when we're going through that season where life doesn't make sense, when we're walking through that valley of the shadow of death in our own circumstances, in our own life, in our own career, in our own culture. Wouldn't life be better if this pain didn't exist? It may be something that you've thought at some point. And so James addresses this in this moment, and he says that when this comes, when the pain shows up, it's not about getting rid of the pain or getting out of the pain. It's not about fixing the problem. It's about growing in the middle of it. Because maturity, this faithful endurance, maturity is gratitude for what you have, not longing for what you want. And so joy, as we talked about last week, doesn't come from acquisition. It doesn't come from just acquiring and getting and gathering and collecting and having all of the right circumstances with all of the perfect climate and the temperature and the thermostat just right and living in this perfect world. It doesn't come from that at all. And we saw that last week it comes from relinquishment, that it's giving up, not picking up and gaining more and more. Dallas Willard, a spiritual growth guru of our day, has written so many books and great resources on what it looks like to grow as a follower of Jesus, what it looks like to grow in life and how we grow to maturity as people. And he said there's three things in what he calls the growth triangle, three things that lead to spiritual growth. Number one, spending time with Jesus. Dallas Willard says, regular spiritual disciplines actually grow you to be more like Jesus. Imagine that. Spending time with someone makes you more like that someone. Dallas Willard said that's part of how we grow. Number two, it's by following the lead of the Holy Spirit. Listening and actually doing what Jesus says in our life leads to growth. But then Dallas Willard said something interesting. He said the third part of this growth triangle is perseverance in trials. It's time with Jesus. It's saying yes to what Jesus wants in your life. And it's perseverance through trials. That's how we experience growth in life. And James says, be joyful because trials are a pathway to maturity. Let me take it a step further. James says that we should rejoice in trials because they test our faith and develop our maturity. Can I go further? James says that he wants the church to live out its faith in the crucible of life in all its tests. But James is certain of this, that these difficulties in life, these tests, these trials, these problems, these pressures that we all face, they can cause doubts. Like, how in the world are we going to get through this? You may look at what's happening in your life, in your family, at your school, with your friends, with the relationships that you hold dear, and you might look at it and think, how in the world are we ever going to get through this? You may resonate with Joe Exotic when he said, how in the world will I ever recover from this financially? You may wonder that. You may doubt. And James knew that. And so that's why he says in verse 5, if any of you lacks wisdom, if any of you doesn't understand how you're going to get through this, if you don't know what it's going to take to get to the other side, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it'll be given to him. But let him ask in faith, with no doubting, for the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea that's driven and tossed by the wind. For that person must not suppose that he'll receive anything from the Lord. He's a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. James knew, let me just tell you, when life happens, when circumstances change, when difficulty shows up, when problems arise and pressure seems like it's going to cave you in, let me tell you what's going to happen. Number one, if you're taking notes, when pressure rises, doubt can creep in. You're going to be tempted to doubt. When we go through the difficult season in life, when we go through that confusing moment in the day, we're tempted to doubt in that moment. God, where are you? God, where are you now? Everything seemed to be going just fine, as if God is a simple genie in a bottle, as if God is a product from a vending machine that when we put in the right things, when we press the right numbers and the right buttons, we get the God that we expect. And when life doesn't turn out the way that we had hoped, when life begins to spiral out of control, when chaos and crisis come knocking at our door, our first temptation is, God, where are you? God, do you know what's happening in my life? Can you see what I'm going through right now? God, if you can see, do you even care about what's going on in my life? And God, if you do care, can you even do anything about what's happening in my life? Doubt begins to creep in when pressure rises. And so James, as he's addressing this doubt, he uses the Greek term diakrino, which means to separate or withdraw. When we go through hard times, which we all do, James knows that our first reaction, our reflex default, is to withdraw. We withdraw from the church, say, God, I'm just going through this painful time. I'm not gonna connect in community anymore. We withdraw from God. God, if this is how you are, if you were really good, you would change things in my life and not let me go through this and not force me to walk through this valley. We withdraw from the church, we withdraw from God, and we withdraw from others. We begin to isolate. And so in these moments of difficulty, James says doubt begins to creep in and we start to creep out. We start to withdraw. And James isn't just talking to people who are on the fringe, who are out on the edge. Maybe they're considering following Jesus. James isn't just talking to people who are like hanging on by a dirty band-aid. No, he's talking to people who are committed followers of Jesus, who've some of them lost loved ones because they're following Jesus. He's talking to people who are all in, who've given everything. Some of them changed their entire lives, their careers, their life's trajectory just to follow Jesus. These are the people that he's talking to. And James takes it a step further and says, look, I'm not just talking about people who experience difficulties because they're poor. No, James expands the net here and says, This happens to both the rich and the poor. James says that trials show up on those who've got a whole lot and those who have a whole lot of nothing. Trials and tribulations and difficulties show up regardless of your status, James is going to say. This is how he says it in verse 9. He says, let the lowly brother boast in his exaltation and the rich in his humiliation, because like a flower of the grass, he'll pass away. For the sun rises with its scorching heat and withers the grass. Its flowers fall and its beauty perishes. So also will the rich man fade away in the midst of his pursuits. James reminds us that troubles are the great equalizer of life. But he doesn't just stop with the trials that show up in everyone's life. He takes it to the next step. He says in verse 12, blessed, happy, joyful, satisfied, blessed is the man who remains steadfast. There's that word again, that faithful endurance, that maturity, that growth that God cultivates. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he'll receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. James isn't just talking about making a little fridge magnet that says, God helps those who help themselves. So when you're going through a tough time, get to work. No, James doesn't just give a catchy little Henry Blackaby devotional or provide us a little Beth Moore study to kind of get us through this season until we get to the next one, and then he'll provide something else. No, this is a solid foundation regardless of the foundation around us. This is a solid promise regardless of the problems that we're facing. James says, blessed is the man when the waves come, when the wind blows, when the scorching heat of life, we know about some scorching heat in the month of May. Can I get an amen? When the scorching heat comes down and everything around starts to wither and everything around starts to crumble, when the waves come, when the diagnosis shows up, when the stock market crashes, your loved one walks out, your child walks away from the faith, when the diagnosis is terminal, the wind and the waves show up in your life, we have a Savior who has experience in this. It's on his resume. What happened when the wind and waves showed up and Jesus is on the boat? He was sleeping. He was calm. But he got up and it says that he calmed the wind and the waves. When the wind comes into your life, when the waves come crashing down in your family, Jesus has experience in this. And his experience is to bring calm. The anxieties that overwhelm us on a regular basis, a daily basis, a weekly basis, when you walk into that meeting, the depression that never seems to lift, the darkness that's always and ever present in your life, what happens in those moments, God can calm your worries and your anxieties. Well, watch what James says in verse 16. Don't be deceived. Don't buy the lie. Friends, don't think that circumstances have the final say. Don't be deceived, James says, my beloved brothers. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Listen, the people in this story in James, the people living in very real difficult times, the people walking through these overwhelming circumstances, had no idea what we'd be walking through in 2022. James had no concept of some of the crises we'd be facing in our culture today. But Jesus never changes. He didn't change in these people's lives, and he's not going to change in ours. Jesus, who is without change or variation, James says this, of his own will, he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. See, James knew that in these moments we doubt God. And he's saying, don't for a second doubt the goodness of God in the trials of your life. Don't for a second think God is absent or off the clock. Don't for a minute in your life believe the lie. Don't be deceived into thinking that your circumstances mean Jesus isn't still present. James knew that when pressure rises, we are tempted to doubt. But he also knew this Here's what else is going to happen when pressure rises in your life. Number two, when pressure rises, we're going to be tempted to compare. We're going to be tempted to compare our lives, what we do know about our lives, with what we don't know about someone else's life. We're tempted to compare the very real problems that we have with the highlight reel that everyone else has. You think, well, Brandon, I'm not much on comparison. I'm not one to just look at what everyone else has. I'm just trying to focus on my own life. But James knew this was going to be a problem, knew this could be a temptation for us. And if we're being honest, we do this, whether we turn on the TV or pull up social media. We compare our very real issues with their highlight reels on social media, and we start to begin to get into this mindset of, oh man, they're going on vacation again, and I am stuck at home. Or we start to look at the pictures of their kids and say, oh, their kids don't have the issues that my kids have. Their marriage looks like it's great. They're going out to eat all of the time. They're just living the life that I've always dreamed. They're living the American dream. James says, don't do it. Don't do it. Theodore Roosevelt said, comparison is the thief of joy. James knew that. He just said it a little bit different, a little bit earlier than Teddy Roosevelt said it. He said, consider it pure joy in trials, because you're going to be tempted to look at other people and compare, but it's when you compare, it's just not real. Ronald Rollheiser said it this way. He said, so much of our unhappiness comes from comparing our lives, our friendships, our loves, our commitments, our duties, our bodies, our sexuality, to some idealized and non-Christian vision of things which falsely assures us that there is a heaven on earth. When that happens, and it does, when that happens, our tensions begin to drive us mad, and in this case, to a cancerous restlessness. And yet we do it every day. You ever come to the end of a day where you've had a really good day at work, you've had a really good day at school, you've had a productive day, you've seen some of the things that you set out to do realized later in the day, and you get to the end of the day, you crawl into bed, and right before you turn the light out and close your eyes, you just pull up social media, you pull up Instagram, and start to think, well, why does their marriage seem like it's always working out and mine never does? Why does it seem like their kids behave and I struggle to get mine to say yes to even good things? Why does it look like they're fully rested and my kids haven't slept for 10 years? Why does it look like they're living the American dream and I'm living in my own nightmare? That's what happens when we compare. And James shows us, when you're in trial, you're going to deal with doubt, you're going to deal with comparison. Going to be moments in this comparison when you feel inadequate, insecure, you start to doubt yourself, irrelevant, and you just start to live in this constant state of stuck and sad. And James reminds us, if you persevere in trials, it'll produce peace and joy and maturity. And James makes us a promise that we can hold on to this morning, whatever you're going through. You may be here in this room carrying some very real pain. You may be joining us online right now, not here in this room, because of the very real pain you're carrying. And James says this, perseverance through trials, when you do, you're going to lack nothing. There won't be anything that you need. There won't be anything that you don't have. And I understand, I know, because I've sat with some of you, the struggles that you're walking through are very real and very tangible and very overwhelming. The things that you're dealing with, the questions that you're having to answer, the answers that you're having to provide in culture and in seasons like we're in, I know it's hard. I know it's difficult, but James promises us that as we persevere in trials, we get peace, we can have joy, and that we can have maturity, lacking nothing. The great theologian Bruce Lee once said, don't pray for an easy life. Pray for the strength to endure the difficult one. But if we're being honest, many of us, if not most of us, would say, I just wish it was easier. I just wish things could be a little bit more simple. But James reminds us that a degree of adversity is necessary for all development, especially endurance. James reminds us that no significant accomplishment is possible in our life unless we learn to persevere through trials. He reminds us that these trials just expose our weaknesses so that we know and can begin to work on areas where we need to grow. This difficulty in life exposes our own sin and our own inability to reform ourselves and exposes us that we need a Savior, not just in salvation, but in the day-to-day of our life. We can't avoid difficulty. We can't dodge the bullet, but we can make the decision to respond with a confident, defiant joy in the moment. Some of you are in a trial right now, and you can't believe this concept that God still cares for you. You can't believe with the pain that you're carrying, the difficulty that you're navigating, the questions that you have, you can't believe that God's allowing this to happen. And you're experiencing so much pain, but you're also asking the question, does God even care? And it's so difficult when you find yourself navigating these moments. And I want you to know that your heavenly Father is looking on and saying, let perseverance finish its work. When we lived in California, we had a backyard that had no yard at all. Everything in California is close in proximity. And so in our backyard that was really just a concrete patio, we had a little trampoline. And when I say little, I mean like big enough for one little kid to jump on. And there was a time when Bauer was out jumping on the trampoline and he tumbled. And in spite of the net that was on the trampoline, his head bounced off of a concrete fireplace outside. Not because of any negligence, but when something like this happens, kids with a scratch on their head, I mean, just bleed like a stuck pig. And so we rushed him off to the urgent care, and I'll never forget just the time that it took for them to begin to wrap his head and put some gauze and get the bleeding to stop, and they began to suture things up with staples. And I remember just saying to him and looking at him as he was so scared and so overwhelmed and in so much very real pain, it's okay, buddy. They're almost done. Just let them finish what they've started. James, in this moment, in this opener of his letter to people he knew and loved, people he knew and loved were going through difficulty, were in real pain, he reminds them what God is reminding us today: let perseverance finish its work. God's not done in your life. God's not abandoned circumstances in your life. God's not walked away. God's not given up. God is still with you, and he's still working in you. James just reminds us that God's concern in our life isn't for our comfort. It's for growth in our character. So what's God doing in you, even though things are tough around you? What's God doing inside of you when things outside all around us are crippling? In your struggles, in your suffering, it may seem like God is done. But the reality is he's just begun. And he's doing his greatest work in you as a good, good father. So may we say today, God, I'm not asking you to change my circumstances. I'm asking you to change me. Let's pray. God, we are grateful that you're still at work in dark times. We're grateful that you're still at work in difficult seasons. God, we're so grateful that you continue to work in us when things are crumbling around us. And so, God, in this moment, in these seasons, in these situations and circumstances that we find ourselves in that we don't want to be in, may we find joy in you. Confident that you put even the pains of our life in the win column. Confident that you put them in the profit column for our good. We know that's possible. We know that's not just likely, but we're confident that's what happens because we're confident in Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. This isn't just a name that we speak about. It's not a name that we just sing about. This is a name that can change everything in your life. That's what God wants to do in your life. Wherever your life may be, wherever you may find yourself, know that there's a God who loves you, who has a purpose for you, and wants nothing but the best for you. It may not feel like it at times. You may look out and it may not seem like God is doing anything, but I want you to begin to think, what does God want to do in me with everything happening around me? Have that conversation over lunch. Have that conversation on your way to lunch. Have that conversation as the commercial breaks on the PGA Championship are on today. But think through what God's doing in you as it feels difficult all around you. Hope you have a great, great week. We're going to continue on verse by verse, word for word through the book of James. Hope you're enjoying it as much as we are. Have a great week. We'll see you next week. God bless.